Dr. Pepper has a Dr. Pepper with cream soda now.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Like mixed in?
Yeah, it's half Dr.
Is
Pepper,
that shit
half fucking
legal?
cream soda.
So, how many extra flavors did they add?
There's already what?
23.
Only 23?
That's the original
Oh,
recipe is 23.
yeah. Huh. But cream soda is pretty straightforward. Is there a lot of flavors in cream soda?
It's
Cream soda
cream
ingredients
and soda.
wise?
Duh. Fuck.
What more do you need, man?
Welcome to the Nerdentials Podcast, starring your hosts, Joe Tweedy, Matthew Johnson, Nick Thomas, and Lynn Dudgeon.
Hello, nerds and nerdettes. Welcome back to Nerdentials. It's been way too freaking long. I'm glad you could join us. We're going to cover some of the nerdy essentials.
Hot damn. All right. Host number two. Take two.
Ah! Welcome, nerds! Welcome back to Nerdentials. Your daily dose of the nerdy essentials with your host, Joe, who's number one and most important. And then, across the ether, Nick Thomas! Boop, 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 boop. And then
yeah,
there's
jazz
me,
finish.
Heyo, Lynn Dudgeon. All right, there's me.
Hell, okay.
On to the next.
All right, no, not on to the next. I will say this. All of those were unique in their own way. Yours... You had energy. I don't know where that came from. Where are you at? Where are you at? Show me. Before I move on, where are you at?
We'll go with right about armpits.
Okay,
maybe.
Really? Yeah, I don't really. Not even anywhere near up the head.
Nah, negative no. Ghostwriter.
All right.
This pattern.
I think I gotta catch up.
This pattern
no,
is
no,
cold.
Nicholas, stop. You already told me you can't feel your bottom lip. Stop it. Guys,
but if I drink enough, won't it go the other direction?
Yes.
That is a old wives' tale slash.
I think it's
going to
take some scientific study.
Go ahead. Take some study. We'll wait.
The other one that I've heard is that if you coat your stomach with olive oil, it takes a while for it to sink in. Don't try this at home, kids. It does not work.
You heard it here first. All the warnings have been placed. Okay, while Nick digests that stimulating effect, let's bring back a long hiatus.
Ooh, shit. Yeah, it has been a minute.
A minute.
A
so,
hot minute.
So, guys, let me break. I'm right here and you're way down here, so let's see what happens here.
We are puff puff passing it on to Joe.
Let's unfold it at the beard.
Puff puff, I'm out there.
I know. Okay, here. I'm at the beard level. Let's see what happens. Here we go. Ready?
Okay, go for it. Let's hear it.
Welcome to Nerdentials, your weekly dose of the nerdy essentials covering film, TV, video games, and comic books. I'm your host, Joe Tweeden. And flawlessly delivered after a month of hiatus, I would like to introduce my additional co-hosts. We have over the ether at this point, always has been and still will be for the near future, the Nick Thomas.
What up, guys? How you doing?
How you bringing it, Nick? How you bringing it?
COVID's.
I was looking for your catchphrase, but I like how you're keeping in context with the current circumstances. I was looking for coming in dry, but that's okay.
It's a dry cough
our...
that helps.
A dry cough.
Guys, keep those face masks ready. Additionally, my second co-host of the night, in the same room as me, for the near future, at least for this week, is the Lynn Dudgeon.
Heyo!
Bringing it hot and picking all the mics, I'm sure. I don't know. I won't know.
Every time.
Every time.
It will be peaked every time.
So hot.
Like your interest.
Ooh. Guys, we're being overly excited right now with the interesting intros from all three of these guys because it's been way too long. I think our last official episode, by the time this episode drops, it's going to be a full month, 30 days, 4 weeks.
Indeed.
4/7 in a row of time that we have not been together in this communal state of nerd talk.
4 weeks ago.
Oh. I did sign John Hancock on that.
Anyone that knows what Foursquare actually means might wonder why it's been so soon since, you know what I mean, the whole math thing. I'm not good with old time English, but we'll move on because that's irrelevant right now. I would like to give a brief shout out to our dearly beloved, rest in peace, nerd host, the Matthew Johnson.
Womp, womp, womp.
I just, for a moment, want to say we love you, bro. We miss you. And he's not gone, guys. I didn't mean to make that sound crazy weird, but he is on just a temporary break, but we
will say he is doing him, boo-boo.
He is going to be coming back in the near future, and for now, we, the three right now here, are going to just jumpstart back into the regular nerd talk from week to week. That is the ongoing goal for COVID 2020. Sorry, for the year of the... Anyway, we're gonna make a positive spin on what's been going on for the last couple months.
Go ahead and erase the 4 score. Because I just looked it up. A score is 20 years.
Oh, shoot.
So 80 years and 4 weeks?
In all fairness, when was 1776? It was a hot minute ago. Hey, come on now.
History buff in action here, guys. So we're going to go into any crazy depth this week, but we... just barely a week ago, prior to this surgery. Time to get it hot! We are going to cover a little bit of recent game news, and we'll see where it goes from there. But for now. Yeah. So
I like the voice that we're going into.
Yeah, I'm trying not to go for going into it.
No, I almost did for a minute. Just do it.
So
all I'm saying is do it. Like Nike, just do it.
Just do it.
Please. This one episode, please.
My fellow nerds, we're going to dive into an aspect of pop culture that maybe you're not familiar with. I would like to recall my time in 2008. Sorry. Where we didn't know how good gaming would be in 2020. That's the truth, really.
Or 2021, for that matter.
Which is kind of the precipice of where we're going here.
Or, dare I say, 2077.
I just have to say, though, one thing I got to say about this whole COVID thing is the amount of time we actually get to play games.
Dude. My backlog is loving me.
Your backlog is becoming a little less back and a lot more log. Am I right?
Yeah.
Logging in.
So, guys, do yourself a favor. Sorry. Practice some social distancing. Pick up your controller. Play. Just play.
Play online. Because everyone is right now. That's the gem of this whole thing. But...
Unless you're on PC and then you can still catch viruses. But let's be honest.
But there's an app for that.
There is.
So, The premise for our episode this particular week, this specific coming back into the light of pop culture and news, guys, is we thought we'd do a little bit of a reaction video out one particular side of, I can't call it console war, but it kind of feels like it during this time.
I really hope that it stops being a console war and it can suck a large fatty, but...
But you also come behind and agree with the reason
behind console war. In all fairness, have indulged in both sides of the grass, and I will say... grass is green on every side with the weird dry patches where you put your bounce house.
Really very specific in your analogy there, sir.
And the pool. Yeah. That piece of grass has never come back.
Yeah.
In my defense, I don't know. The last place I rented, shit did buff out.
Yeah, she did buff out. All I'm saying is that, like, 60 by 20 squares kind of fucked.
There's the first F-bomb of a coming back party, guys.
Oh, yeah. Technically still PG-13. It's technically still PG-13.
Oh, you get... Spider-Man says you get two, actually.
Give me a few drinks, and we'll try to avoid the nip slip, but I can't promise anything.
Based on that premise, and
do we need to avoid the nip slip? All right.
Anyway.
So we're doing the Xbox.
We're covering Xbox right now because they're 13 the 13 reasons ones
why.
The balls to reveal any shit right now. I look forward to seeing what Sony comes out with. Hey. This is not a hate. Statement at all. This is just I'd like to see what competition's going to bring. We're waiting,
I think, is the statement everyone's feeling.
Exactly.
Right now. We're waiting. What are you gonna bring that's gonna make Xbox shit its pants?
Well, you might think you're rolling in at 20, but it ends up into an 11, and you can't fix that.
So until we wait for that solid
D20. Yeah, critical one.
until that happens, guys, we're going to spend the next 20-ish minutes reacting to 13 titles that Microsoft revealed during their Xbox Insider weekly, web video that they usually post weekly. We're about to jump into that shortly here, and then we'll give some commentary post too. We'll comment between, and then we'll talk in depth about.
Can I talk over it?
I'm gonna comment during. I'm sorry.
This is a reaction. That's the point. Like the whole thing is, guys, most everyone right now, it's been over a week, has probably watched this presentation by now. Mm-hmm. So it's really going to be a point of we're gonna react, and then we're going to dive in a little deeper on. What we hope out of this, what's not exciting.
I'm pretty sure, Lynn, they will forgive us. Because sometimes you got to comment in between the media center. It's understandable.
Nice visual, Nick.
I also avoided it like it was the plague and waited to partake until we all came together.
And then I wanted to share
my infection with the rest of you.
So sweet.
Wait, and infection?
Sharing is caring.
Wait. Why are you guys not 6 feet apart?
Why is your intoxication level not 6 feet apart?
You're right.
Riddle me
I'm
this.
I'm only 12, riddle me this, 12 inches Batman. Away from the bottles.
Can I just throw this? Let me throw this out there for any of the naysayers. Me and Lynn here, well, Lynn's been the only one working, and his company actually tests him. Me, I have literally been at home for 3 weeks straight, and I've heard you only need 14 weeks of zero symptoms to be seen as relatively safe, minus the testing.
You said 14 weeks? You mean 14 days?
I meant 14 days. Sorry for
No, you heard him correct. 14 weeks.
Longer than we've been in lockdown.
Right? If we're going with the course of the standard directive, 14 weeks is correct.
We haven't even been quarantined 14 weeks, bro.
That's
you have a lot of waiting to do, my good man.
It's only been nine.
Alco's opened up. My bad, guy.
Let's move on. we're just going to confuse people right now.
Right. So, okay, fair enough. My bad, guys.
Unlock that shit. You can hold it. I'll even watch it while you're holding it. Guys, we're going to check out the video here in just a moment. We're going to watch and react as it's happening.
Oh.
So, Nicholas.
Wait, is this game?
That's not the correct video.
What do you mean? Is it 27 minutes?
It's 27 minutes and 44. Okay, it is.
Yeah, it's fine. You were on the right one. Yeah.
Oh, wait. So you mean with the no ads, I was on the correct video?
Yes, you were.
Ready to rock! Let's do this.
Okay. Yeah?
Sounds like a plan, Stan.
Okay.
Okay, so... 3, 2, 1, go.
Roll that beautiful bean footage.
And hopefully we did. And yes, talking over is allowed, but let's try to experience some of it and a little bit of commentary in between.
My headset is very loud.
I'm very sorry, I can't control that. Oh, maybe I can. Is it really too
loud? It's fucking loud.
Is mine too loud?
Ooh.
No, Nick, you're fine.
Dude!
Okay, so we have an FPS, right?
The wall run! Like is this freaking Titanfall?
A lot of water graphics, a lot of quick action.
Looks very Japanese style or Chinese, Asian.
No, the setting,
The slides, yeah. The wall runs. Is this Titanfall?
Yeah. Wall run into a slide. And then a zip line.
This is fucking Titanfall, is it?
No.
Okay, is that a Spartan? No. Wait.
Oh. What, swords and guns?
That was a brutal parry. And then a... Finish him! Get over here!
What does all the gore do?
Oh, yeah.
The last time I saw a tether pull like that was frickin' Bulletstorm.
Just Cause.
No, yeah, for catapulting around the world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I've never played Just Cause, so. Is that the DeLorean?
DeLorean? Oh, yeah, shoot. 22.2 gigawatts. Whoa! It's a chick.
Infinite memory.
Bright memory. Infinite, I think.
Hello.
Bright memory.
Look at Xbox Series X gameplay being broadcast from our homes to yours. My name is Damon, and I have the pleasure of teaming up with our own Sarah Bond to bring you a
sneak
of some of the great games coming to Xbox Series X. What you just witnessed was Bright Memory Infinite from Playism, created from the ground up by a single individual at FYQD Studio in China. Developers are using the hardware to achieve their
one guy and developed this game
in amazing ways, using the power to optimize their games the way they want. You know, higher resolutions, crazy frame rates, ray tracing, and yes, faster in-game load times. But it's also awesome to see the partner support for smart delivery, ensuring that fans only have to purchase the game once to enjoy it on whichever Xbox system they own or will own in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So, over the next 25 smart minutes, delivery. We're going to debut just a slice of the amazing next-gen games you can expect from our partners this holiday and early.
And that's the thing is, I can't wait to see what they're going to reveal
in the next 2 months. Because
can I get a mug of just hot water to dip?
Or is that you only have to buy it once and like buy it on Xbox One and it'll transfer to the Gen X? So
sit back. We'll talk. Let's keep watching, Nick. Yeah. I got info on what that is. Let's keep reacting. We got some more trailers here.
We'll shit talk later.
We will shit talk later. World premiere. As if this were E3.
Again.
I know.
Nuts in a hot mug of water.
Well, I honestly think this is their version of E3 this year because we didn't have it.
Is this the new Forza?
It's not the full one because they've said in July they're going to do Forza? An actual presentation. So this is literally, dude, just a slice of what they were planning for E3.
This is foreplay.
This is what, Nick?
This is foreplay.
Oh, yeah. No. Yeah, Microsoft.
You know, a little tickle before you hide the
balls right now. Yep. Like, I'm not a huge racing fan, but, like, I know it.
For shame. I would kick your ass at any racing game.
I said I enjoy them. I didn't say I was good at them.
I can't think of the last time I lost at Mario Kart, so.
This is a Mario
Kart. Dude. Next time in person, I will rock your world at Mario Kart.
That's a promise, guys. You heard it here first while we're reacting.
Challenge.
To
this. He promised to rock his world.
Can any of you guys guess what franchise this is?
Forza? Oh, Dirt. Oh,
yeah, I know.
Negative Ghost Rider. Hard pass. No, I'm not a fan of Dirt.
No.
I thought the first two Dirts were good. Back in the day.
I will say Dirt 2 is good.
Whoa.
This is the one you pay attention to. I want to see what you guys think about this.
Oh, is this... Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know what to think about it.
I know the style.
Absolutely. But here's the thing. Is they promised before presenting all these teasers, everything was going to be in-engine. I don't doubt that this is in-engine, but this doesn't show off anything about what the gameplay is actually going to be. It gives us the concept for what it is, but...
I actually watched some gameplay of this.
Attack on Titan?
Hold on. Yeah, right.
Dude, it is sick and visceral.
Okay. Share after. We'll keep reacting, but I want to hear what you say about this, Nick. Because I haven't checked out actual gameplay. I didn't know there wasn't.
It's the weirdest nipple ever.
Yeah.
All of this screams Prometheus, like prequel to Aliens type style, but
this is totally Geiger.
Again, I'm gonna have to get you to explain after this. We'll wait.
The original artist that was gonna do Aliens, H.R. Geiger. Is a very well-known artist. He draws a lot of this very xenomorphic, almost very, very disgustingly visceral artwork. And this is very guided.
Yeah, alien and gross, yeah. Dude, this might be like, what is this
like
game about
right
here?
Like, some of his original work was used for, school.
Yeah, right there.
It was used for, like, Hellraiser and shit like that.
Yeah.
All I'm saying is I hate the Scorn. Worst enemy ever.
Never franchise.
Now, if the Scorn were that, would you think they're the worst enemy ever?
Yes.
Well,
yes.
Sure. Deep Silver.
What? I actually know this one.
Hey, wait.
Do you?
Yeah, I've seen this one.
It's got cool space combat.
Weird.
The last game I played that was a Deep Silver was Kuana Sensa? Hellblade?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I just did a Game Pass video.
Yep.
On the
but
first
that wouldn't
Hellblade.
Make sense because that's like medieval Vikings and shit. This is all futuristic space.
Wait, You mean the markings on her forehead and below her eyes have nothing to do with it? And the voices?
Are you trying to make a connection with this game?
I've seen this one.
I know. Are you trying to make a connection with Hellblade in this? Chorus?
Maybe.
Oh.
Alright, I'll pick your brain later.
If you can just make a right turn
and they can
left
help
turn.
Still hold esports, right?
Okay.
Oh,
I want to react to this one just because.
Okay, yeah.
Dude.
This one has a really interesting setting.
Yep.
What in the actual.
This paradox interaction.
Oh.
This web's full of darkness. There is some cool stuff.
Okay, Paradox has made a Magicka.
This. Right here, guys, reminds me of We Happy Few.
Yeah, We Happy Few.
Just like the style, the look of it. Creepier, really screwed up right here.
Yeah.
But I'm just thinking, if this was like a horror movie where the murders were strung up as mannequins, it's really creepy.
Flip the bird. For this being next gen, the textures are kind of bothering me, actually.
Yeah. There's probably a reason why. It's probably huge. Yeah, judging by that.
I think this is an open world game.
Whoa!
So,
that dude is on fire!
Not gonna be gorgeous, but there's gonna be a lot to it.
Nice lip ring.
There you go.
Oh, wait.
There was the texture.
Oh, I forgot.
Go get it, son. He's got purple eyes.
Spoiler warning, guys. Yeah, this is a vampire title.
Oh, yeah.
But
oh,
I'm
shit.
Very I'm still curious about it.
No, I'm not even gonna lie. I'm probably gonna hate it.
Especially
oh, dude, you're not wrong. I don't think this is... I think this is vampire.
It is. I'm pretty sure...
You've watched the recent, the other one, right?
I've watched
all of it. But yeah, Vampire the Masquerade.
Okay.
Bloodlines.
Okay.
They're not going for, like, photorealistic with the characters, but they're going for a creepy look.
No, but they definitely have moments of photorealistic.
Yeah.
They saved it for certain moments, not the whole thing. And I kind of understand that they saved it for important moments. So
right.
This kind of has a Sea of Thieves feel.
Are you familiar with this? Lynn?
Hold on. Yeah.
Am I not wrong? This has like a Sea of Thieves feel.
I mean, it has a similar quality to it. It's definitely not the same.
It's Sea of Thieves meets Savage Planet.
Oh, Nick, have you played Savage Planet at all?
I haven't. Is it good? I dare
say I've found my strength. It is. I did. I posted a video on it. You can check out on our channel. But yeah, it's fun.
Yeah.
You guys, get out there and watch Joe's video. Apparently, it's good. Will we be forgotten
too?
This one looks cool, though. There's a lot of stylistic choices in this. Call of the Sea.
Fingers?
Yeah, okay, I've seen that one.
Like the creature from the Blue Lagoon.
Yeah.
World premiere.
I've been trying to avoid these, but I've seen a couple of them already.
Well, they're in post now. We gotta react. The Ascent
Metropolis. Okay.
Hey.
Seen some mechs and shit. Some futuristic neon holograms. Slaves in all but name. Aliens or mutants? Something? I don't know.
There's definitely some unique characters in this.
Okay.
I'm not sure. I mean, it's got like the cyberpunk feel, but I know it's a very different game.
Huh. I was not expecting a top down.
Diablo, Cyberpunk.
This almost has like a vibe for, do you remember the Overkill games?
Yeah.
Is that no sugar enough yet? Just give it a minute.
I mean, I actually love the Overkill games. They were freaking awesome.
No, like, I love the whole setting, and I'm sold on Cyberpunk, but this might be a nice...
Work together? So we might be able to do some
choice.
Co-op?
My thing is
I'm kind of over top downs.
Really? It's just your
They can keep going. I have no problem with it. It's just I don't like the top down style anymore.
Well, almost photorealistic.
Fuck.
You see the hair on his hands? The pores in the face? That's pretty good.
Yes.
Oh, the water art on the tier. That's kind of cool.
Can't remember what this one is. You already have thoughts on this one. Do you know what franchise this is or what time it is?
We'll come to it in a minute.
Epic stash.
The music kind of throws it into a certain...
That and the guy.
Niche.
The hell? Okay. So it almost looks like she has like a... Remember that Keanu Reeves freaking Constantine movie? Where he'd go between hell and earth?
Or the... Silent Hill.
Hope you enjoyed the reveal of The Medium, our next-gen psychological horror game. We're very excited to announce that we're working on the project in cooperation with the
psychological horror, the definitely Silent Hill.
Best known for the Silent Hill series. We'll have more to reveal soon.
So stay tuned. Oh, whoa.
Composer from Silent Hill series.
Oh.
Are you hating on it because it's not the next Silent Hill, or are you just skeptical about it?
No, it's great. If it lives up to what the trailer is, that'll be great. Right. But all I'm saying is it's very, like, 100% Silent Hill with the transition.
Gotcha. Yeah, I get what you're saying.
And then the feel, and then incorporation of the psychological.
Yeah. You're like, it's a copycat, is what you're feeling right now. Yeah.
Bandai
Namco. And hey, if they do it right, it's fine.
Yeah. Interesting friends or what?
Shin Megami Tensei. I'm just playing. No, I'm just playing. I'd be surprised if it wasn't. The way that the art style looks like, it looks like a Digital Devil Saga.
There's some interesting similarities.
If I am right here on this one, that would be like,
I don't remember.
Two in a row? Another Digital Devil Saga?
I cannot be hurt.
I would love that, not gonna lie. I would dump $100+ into another digital level.
My power is psychokinesis.
Ready? Feels like it. Yeah. Most definitely.
Ooh.
Oh yeah.
Almost has like a
different
action RPG feel.
Yeah. I was just gonna say it doesn't. Like, all the digital levels were turn-based. This looks like very much action. And if you have not played Digital Devil, go out and check it out.
I'll definitely give it a look. I'll take the high recommendation here. Consider it shit.
Very militant JRPG style.
Oh, lot of classic over the top action going on.
Scarlet Nexus.
Who's the... So it's Bandai,
yeah,
but
Bandai
who's
Namco
the...
and Unreal Engine.
Who's the director of it, though?
we'll look into it.
Wait a tick.
Another Scarlet game. Hey, look, it's a shotgun. That kind of looks like the Doom shotgun.
Systemic reaction.
Oh, it's not Doom.
Oh.
Earth
what,
has
are those
fallen.
Dinosaurs?
Oh no.
Rally your squad? Oh.
Is this like Turok Next Gen or something?
Yeah, that's what
dude,
it looks
like. Dude, is
this
like a... What was that? It was made by the same people that made Resident Evil, but you had dinosaurs?
Oh, yeah, I could see it.
Or
that
Turok had dinosaurs. Oh, okay.
Second Extinction.
I like a good shooter. Especially.
Oh, man.
Oh, I saw this preview, actually.
Yeah.
I saw this.
Oh, man.
It's a Yakuza. It's the... Is it the seventh?
Yeah.
Title?
I don't know where this is going. This is a good one.
It's, I think, Blood Dragon or something. It's a continuation from his legacy.
It's the new one.
Yeah. And then also, I did an Xbox Game Pass playthrough of... Yakuza 0 and Yakuza Kiwami, which is a remake of the original. And 0 is a prequel to the original.
Your prequel.
It's him right there.
Isn't it supposed to continue like a legacy of him? It's not him specifically.
No, 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 no.
Follows him a new guy.
Dunn got capped.
He did, but he didn't.
Was he Negan now?
No, I don't know if this is a Yakuza game, but it's...
It is.
Oh, yeah.
It is. It's Yakuza, colon, Dragon Blood Dragon something.
Yeah, Blood Dragon.
It's the seventh one, yeah.
The deciding to go with the over-the-top.
Yep.
Yeah, it was. Indeed, it was.
Yeah, dude.
Like a dragon. Oh my gosh, they did go the over the top.
It probably still has the same depth. Here he is.
I will pay extra for this. Series の最新作であるヤクザ Like a Dragon を Xbox Series X のローンチタイトルとしてそして Xbox One や Windows 10で発売する運びとなりました。
Windows 10? My new computer, I can enjoy this game on it? Hell yeah!
楽しんでいただきたいなというふうに考えております。ゲームの限界に挑戦する
I will
スタジオの新たな挑戦を
I've loved all the Yakuza games.
というふうに考えております。ヤクザ、ライクアドラゴンをぜひよろしくお願いします。
Thank you!
I hope you all enjoyed this brief peek at just some of the titles we have lined up for Xbox Series X. This is just the beginning. And personally, I can't wait to get immersed in these games.
Just the beginning,
game.
Nick.
But until then,
just
I'm
the beginning.
Just going to have to live out that fantasy via
Oh, there's a Valhalla teaser at the end of
that. Yeah.
How about I
you
try
want
out
to see it?
Now.
You want
I do.
Yeah,
I want to see
the
it.
World
I've
Scarlet
avoided
now.
The
Valhalla. Yeah. Maybe I could tear up the streets in Dirt 5.
Liv's been avoiding the newest Assassin's Creed.
Phil Spencer
dude,
Sherlock.
But here we are.
I did
We've
a real good job of avoiding the Death Stranding
game.
Gameplay until
so
like a week
that,
ago.
Here comes
the
or
two
right, come on.
The last Assassin's Creed game I played.
Huge
was
thanks
Assassin's
to all of our
Creed
partners
Brotherhood.
For their hard work during these
Ooh,
times.
That's a good one. That's a good
today's lineup and hear more about their
thoughts on the main.
We'll discuss
see you later
afterwards.
This summer for even more
because,
everything after that until
Origins was back and our partners worldwide. Thanks so much.
Let's react to Valhalla. I'm curious about Nick's reaction to this since he hasn't seen anything past the newest, you know? Like how they are now.
If he says Fusarada at least once in this, I'm done.
Okay, he had a good reaction to the
magical sail.
Well, he had a reaction to the seafaring aspect. He's like, wait a minute, is that CG or combat?
Wieners?
Shh. Stonehenge. Stop it. That's right, Nick. 9th century Vikings in France.
What?
What do you mean?
What do you seems mean? Like you're abandoning all historical realism.
I don't want to. I want to kind of cover a little bit of commentary on everything we watched. So I don't want to make this all just about the freaking last. Let's pick a separate episode to dive in more deep on Assassin's Creed. Since
shit, no, I've got.
Let's make commentary. I want to have it, but I just don't want to make it an hour long
like
talk.
In the middle of there were a couple of games that are kind of like.
So what I'm gonna do, real quick. We just came off of that entire video reaction, and the thing is like, you okay?
I caught.
I don't want to.
You have it on video. I caught it.
Oh, I can't wait to see it in editing.
No, you don't.
Stop it. Anyway, so Nick hasn't seen anything since Brotherhood, and the thing is, regardless of your opinion regarding
all there, of there the was others, a reason they it felt like they were rushing the games out just to make a release.
I enjoyed Unity. I enjoyed all of them after Brotherhood. I'm sorry if the fan base consensus, or maybe it's just you personally, decided to hate all of them after that.
I didn't say I hate.
No, Nick, Lynn, you don't hate. You're practically Canadian. You don't hate anything. You can be horrifically disgusted with things, but you'll never say the word hate. I get it. You will very eloquently critique the shit out of something to where you would think someone would hate it, but you will never say hate. I'm beating you up a little bit.
There were other games in that moment that were better bug tested and better developed.
I want to preface my discussion on this.
I will say that the premise, the time period, and the overall plot were decent.
Of
Unity and Syndicate.
So
I can honestly say,
can I sit, hold on.
I will also say
I want to hear Nick's point.
Black
and
Flag was not a favorite of mine either.
It was a favorite.
It was good, but it wasn't a favorite.
So the discussion, you guys can stop me. I'm not like the. What do you call it? The brain of this operation or discussion. I try very hard to lay out context for what we're going to talk about, and I try to keep it balanced enough that this doesn't become a shit on this or shit on that.
Well, I mean, I'm not even.
And that's never your angle. I get it.
I'm not shitting on anything. I'm here. I'm saying.
But
this is fine. So it's cool that they're making another game. But I'm saying in the middle of the video that we watched, there were games that I do have comments on.
Okay.
That I am excited for.
So I want to keep the Assassin's Creed thing brief only because he has a lot more to say on all the things that we did watch.
So do I.
And you okay? And your context ends with Brotherhood as far as the franchise is concerned.
The only thing
regarding
Assassin's
Creed.
Yeah. Only thing I got to say about this Assassin's Creed Valhalla, because of the context of what this one's going to be based about, and because of my personal hobby, I'm going to buy the shit out of this.
Okay. I guess
the Viking era, especially around the 9th, 10th century Viking era, is a very brutally horrific time period.
Because if you look up anything online, that's what they'll tell you about this particular game, is it's 9th century France and Vikings. Regardless of what was in the trailer, though, the only thing I wanted to say, just to clarify where I stand, because just to add a voice to it, Nick ended a long time ago with Brotherhood, which was only a spin-off sequel to Assassin's Creed 2, which happened over 10 years ago. I will also vouch by saying that I can't back up everything authentically from the perspective that I played through all of them.
I can say that I have played through all of them.
Which I will give you your ground, dude. I'm not gonna pull that out from under you.
I'm saying, so like, there was Assassin's Creed, what was it, 3, with you playing as a native.
Civil War, George Washington.
Yeah, that was fun. I will say the Assassin Turkey was great. And then there was the spinoff on that one. That one was...
Was it Black Flag?
No, Black Flag was its own standalone game. But
wasn't Black Flag the main character from 3's father?
They are connected, but
because I read
you
through
find
it,
out in Revelations, which is 3, the spin-off.
The main character is Connor.
Yes, in 3,
a Native American born assassin.
Yeah.
So it's Assassin's 1, Assassin's 2, the spin-offs Brotherhood and Revelations, which became their own trilogy, tying up Ezio's storyline, which I recently bought super cheap on Xbox Live, the Ezio collection, which is anyway.
I will say that I did get Assassin's Creed 3 for the PlayStation and the Switch, and the kids play it on Switch. Shameless that they play it, but whatever. Anyway, there's Black Flag, and then the spinoff of Black Flag, whereas you play as the Commodore of...
That's weird, because I thought Black Flag was a spinoff of 3, because it was a mid-generation 360 Xbox One title, which sold dual copies for Black
Creed, Black Flag, and then Rogue.
Oh, no, sorry.
And then it was Rogue.
Sorry. Black Flag was only on 360, and they never ported it to Xbox One until recently.
Yes.
Which I now have.
Yes.
So did I.
And then it was Rogue. Wasn't
it?
Yes.
Yeah, at one point they made it free.
And then it was Rogue. And then, which one was it?
Unity. But here's the thing. I came into Unity after all the bugs and all the hate
had been patched
that
up.
Ensued were gone and done.
Yes.
And what sucks is Syndicate, which was an insanely awesome setting, 18th century London, with co-op mode where you played a brother and sister, was an incredible iteration coming off of Unity, but it sold so poorly because so many people hated Unity, and they were, at the time, Ubisoft was year to year, like Call of Duty style release, and there was no time for the franchise to breathe from the mistakes of Unity. And even though I enjoyed it post all the fixes.
I will throw this out there.
Yeah.
Tony and Owen, their favorite game out of the Assassin's Creed franchise is Unity and Syndicate.
Yeah, I love both of those, and I came in it post all the mistakes.
There is also the other games which are in there, which you own and is in our library of the side scrollers.
Oh yeah,
and
those were fun.
Yes.
Russia, China, and India
exactly
were the settings.
I actually and those played were called side-scroller the ones. I really enjoyed them.
Assassin's Creed Chronicles is yep. the side-scrolling.
And see, Nick did, and he did which one play did
you
those. Play, Nick?
Or did you play all of them, or did just
which well, ones? Well, the side-scroller, the China and the Russia, I'm pretty sure they came for free on Xbox Live.
And I played I through them. I think all three of them eventually became free over time. They did at one point. I might have paid for one of them, but they were all free at one point. India, but I did China, enjoy them. Yeah.
I will say, though, that the break and when Origin came out.
Okay. I jumped in on Origins when it came out as well. And here's where, just to, we can cut this out and make it a separate episode if we need to, but I do want us to unfold this briefly for Nick. Because he doesn't know where the franchise goes post typical Assassin's Creed.
Yeah.
So, Nick,
I actually do. I had a 3-hour conversation with a coworker, but thank you. Go ahead.
Okay, let's have the conversation now as if it were fresh. But regardless.
I do have quips with Origin. I do have things that I love about Origin. And I do have things that just outright kind of sucked about Origin. So, and it's nothing super negative. The thing that super sucked was the microtransactions or the pay to skip.
Okay, so
that one, you don't have to dive into it. You don't have to do it. But the fact that it's there.
So.
And the fact that they try to take advantage and further promote people's I want it now thing kills me.
So I'm going
to pay to win.
Hold on. Nick, I'm gonna take both sides on this thing. Nick, I know that the moment you hear that, you're shitting bricks, and Lynn is very passionate about it as well and has to bring it up as a topic. But it can't be dismissed. I'm not trying to pretend it doesn't exist. I know it exists, I know there's a hatred for it.
Well, my thing is like in Destiny with the account recovery. The pay to skip type thing, it kills me. It's
so
it further. What do we say? It is it further promotes the normalization of deviation from gameplay. So a game is meant to be played to escape. But in making these transactions or these pay to skip type things available, it makes it normal and acceptable to advance based on the fact that you have money or the money to dump into it or just the fact you can't wait or have patience. All I'm saying is that there's a sense of accomplishment when you dump that 250, 500 hours into a game to finally get something that you've worked so hard towards and then have another guy come along maybe not even 3 days into launch and he was able to dump $200, maybe $500 into the game and skip everything to get all this shit right at the beginning. It's like, okay, cool. You didn't experience any of it. It's the point of the thing that the developers and the artists and everybody put all the effort into the game for. You're not enjoying it. You're not, you know, living it or escaping from the mundane lifestyle that you have.
Yeah.
That you paid for the game. It's just, it's frustrating, but anymore, that's how anything is. So, it's you pay to have fun. My slogan, you pay to have fun.
Oh no. And I think we all agree with the frustration of that, Lynn, and anything I'm about to say right now is not intended to dismiss that frustration because I agree with it. It's a nice hot topic that everyone talks about constantly because as gamers, we think it's stupid, benign, beneath the idea of what video gaming
should be. And so I completely agree with you that I would like to openly promote and disband the idea of doing it, and I wish developers could discover a different way or a different method for hitting their budget line or covering the cost of developing a game.
It's not even developers.
Hold
it's
on. I will pause one thing for just a second because I understand the perspective you're coming at. You're coming at it from an angle of EA, and we've had this conversation
down that direction. That's okay, then a dark
let's road. Change it. Let's change this thing.
Does
Ubisoft develop through EA? Are those the connections? Am I wrong or right?
No. Ubisoft is standalone.
Okay. Let's not make this episode about that. Let me just go back to the core of...
What I'm saying is the developers are the ones who coded it, that did the art up, that made the game what it is. There are other entities, which I'm not bringing up, that are the ones that are pushing these other side things that deviate from what the developers and the people who put the love into the game. And that's one that we downloaded last night, and I said I legitimately wanted to cry because it brought back childhood memories of what I imagined, or like what you said, what I imagined the game to look like when I was younger, and then now it's finally able to be visualized as a legitimate thing.
Yeah.
And what is that game? There's none of these things. They even pushed it out like 4 or 5 times just to make it look as good as it does.
Development time. Yeah.
And I appreciate that. There's no skips. There's no pay to advance. This game is fucking beautiful because of the time and effort put into it. And what a lot of these games nowadays, like a lot of the other topics that we were talking about, it's just you don't enjoy it because you're too worried about FOMO.
So, and that's
your fear of missing out of what other people have gotten that you don't have.
So here's what I'd like to instill in this conversation, and I definitely think, like, don't be upset about this. Hopefully Nick can be awake for the other reaction stuff.
Nicholas? I'm awake.
I know. Okay. I'm only saying that is I feel like this conversation I may pull out as a 20, 30-minute excerpt on the topic that it is very specific to. Having said that, let me help us conclude the discussion about this topic involving Assassin's Creed specifically, because that's what we were reacting to versus expectations. Hold on. Just give me second. And if you feel like you have something to counter...
It wasn't in Unity and it wasn't in Syndicate. It was only in Origins and Beyond.
Okay. So I'm going to respond to that specifically.
Okay.
On the one hand, I'm not blind, I'm not ignorant to the fact that microtransactions exist in the franchise ever since Origins going forward. Okay. What I would like to promote to our listeners or anyone who in our community who is like-minded in the perspective that I maybe this is news to some of my hosts. I don't know. I'm just going to throw this out on the table and we'll see what the reaction is. But, like, I've always appreciated Lynn's pay-to-have-fun statements because it always brings up the reality of what's going on from a publisher standpoint, not necessarily the developer standpoint. We've seen so many developers push hard, work hard. They're men and women like us who work overtime hours trying and crunch time and all that controversial bullshit of trying to push out a game on a development dateline that is oftentimes pushed by the publisher who is funding a lot of their project that's sometimes out of the developer's hands. And so, out of context of that, my main response, concluding where Lynn was coming from, is that, yeah, that is absolutely frustrating. I'm on the same page as him. All of us agree that microtransactions suck. It's a weird, crappy way for publishers to make their back end and get their money back after pumping money out to a developer who, and for all intents and purposes, we don't have the full understanding or ideology of what it takes, or the knowledge or actual experience of how complicated game development, coding, and all these other things are. We do know from many different sources, other podcasts, other interviews we've heard, game development does take a lot of effort, a lot of work. And publishers aren't looking at the effort and time work. They're looking at the bottom line and how much money they can get back. So from that standpoint, that's why microtransactions exist, sadly, to the consumer level, us, the gamers that pay for the games. And moving forward from that, though, just so that was just kind of my like conclusion. Like, we all understand it sucks this in the way microtransactions are and exist. We hate, but hold on. Like,
okay,
we've heard, Lynn, you say how much it's shitty and it sucks. Like, but I
want to throw
an hour long conversation.
No. Like, okay. I have one hard throw in there.
Go ahead.
I will say, the microtransactions that I do enjoy paying for, the ones that I love, are like the art books, the soundtracks. I don't like the pay to skip, the pay to have a better weapon, the pay to have an experience bonus. I like the maybe the out of game content that's there.
The tips we give to our service for the extra effort they put in to push stuff out.
Exactly. Like the things where you get to enjoy the artwork or the style of the game, or just additions to it that aren't in-game monotonous things that you'll use probably once or twice in a playthrough and then be done.
Absolutely agree with you. And I also agree, I'm more than willing to pay for bonus content that doesn't relate to...
Even if the digital art book was priced at a egregious amount and it went towards the developers, I would dump the money into it. I'm not even going to lie. Because like the one that I'm talking about that we had just downloaded, dude, if that thing cost like $150... I would still pay into it if I knew that money was going to development.
Just to break the fourth wall, I don't have a problem calling it out that Lynn bought the special whatever edition of Final Fantasy VII that, much to my personal dismay, is exclusive to PlayStation for at least a year before it comes to Xbox. But the point is
that... Yeah, I wasn't happy about that either.
We knew you were going to say that, Nick, which is why Lynn was trying to avoid it, because we don't want to get into a debate about exclusivity shit. We're just talking.
I have to say. Well, I disagree with the exclusivity.
We all disagree with it. This is not the main focus of this conversation. They did release
a remake of this, not a remake, but a HD upgrade of the 7, the original, for Xbox. And I was glad they did that, so I can at least enjoy it.
Yes, and I just downloaded 9 from Game Pass. They're going to come out with 8 and 7 through Game Pass soon.
It's already there. I've downloaded 7, 8, 9, 10, X2 when they had their sale last month. They had a sale on all of them.
Okay, a sale. You bought them. My statement was they're going to be free on Game Pass in the next couple of months. That's where you threw me off. I'm like, well, are you... with me because like I keep up to date with all Game Pass shit. I didn't realize you meant it's on the Xbox store that you can actually buy. I didn't know that.
No, but it's
props to you, because I'd be willing to buy them myself as well.
Yeah,
but I also knew that they were coming to Game Pass, and 9, they're coming out in different orders, but 9 just became completely free on Game Pass 2 days ago, and I downloaded it. And 8 and 7 and 10 and everything prior to 11 is coming to Game Pass. Game Pass. Hashtag love you, Game Pass. Anyway.
But, like, ultimately, like we're saying is, or like I'm saying is that I would enjoy paying to the developers as opposed to the little tiny, here's the little boost, but it's going to cost you $40 to $50. That's kind of painful. Whereas, you know, like I'm saying, an art book or a soundtrack, I'll dump the money into.
I do that too for any franchise I love.
Any day of the week.
Developer I mean, I want to support.
I don't even care if it's a franchise that I love. If I know that it's something other than a little bullshit microtransaction.
I know.
It's like we were talking with the Fallout shelter. I get that it's a phone game. I get that it's riddled with microtransactions out the asshole.
Can we just
like
Nick is fully aware, can we just make a general statement that
no, it's
Bethesda and Fallout right now.
That's
in a whole nother hemisphere of screwed up.
I wasn't doing the Bethesda. I'm just saying that
it's all connected though. Even the mobile game is from Bethesda.
Yeah, but so
point is,
my thing is just the if there was more.
They've made the console edition of 76 out to be a mobile game.
More as far as beef, how screwed up.
Yeah,
so. More beef to the sandwich. I would pay for it.
Absolutely. Only thing I wanted to share with Nick, aside from the disposition of what Ubisoft has done with the franchise regarding external money-earning sources, was to talk about the games themselves. Like, I know we can't dismiss the existence of, oh, I can click on the store button and wow, there's a 500... things that are 99 cents to 100 bucks and it's all microtransaction bullshit. I just wanted to cover the part specifically before we end this segment here. Is Nick's only understood the franchise as far as how the game plays physically from a gamer to gameplay, that he's only seen it through the classic sense of what Assassin's Creed is, where it's A to B missions, it's parkouring and collecting. It's a collecting game.
Yeah.
And he's only seen it through Brotherhood, which is a spinoff to the second one. So it's like the third game ever released.
Borgia flags, the feathers, and all that.
So Assassins 1, 2, Brotherhood. Three games into the franchise, only 5 years total into from the conception of 1 to the release of Brotherhood. And 5 games later, we get Assassin's Creed Origins, and yes, it had a lot of flack for microtransactions, but for me,
it's a good game.
The game itself, Lynn is trying to say he still thinks it's a good game, aside from the bullshit that they're trying to make money off of. And that was my perspective, what I was trying to share is that we spent years talking about microtrans, and I just want to say that, let's get dip out for a second, I'll just finish my brief thought. If it's one of my kids, I may have to take care of it. You need to go to bed. No. Okay, I think it's one of Lynn's kids. Okay. This isn't something that he'd be upset about not being able to react to. It's just a very broad statement about the direction of the games, Nick, that I wanted to share with you. Lynn will be back in just a moment. But aside from microtransactions, which I think they've done less of, but as far as like physical mechanics direction changes that the franchise has made, aside from historical accuracy, because Nick, you can't tell me that you've hoped that they would maintain 100% accuracy in historical shit, because there is a huge layer of fantasy, sci-fi, fiction layered into the entire franchise, and there always has been. Even back in Brotherhood. Because Brotherhood's as far as you've ever gotten, and that was back in the heyday prime of the sci-fi back and forth of what Assassin's Creed started as, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
You know? Origins was so close to ancient Egypt, the way it was set up.
Okay, yeah.
That they have actually used the Origins engine for, like, freaking tours of what ancient Egypt would have looked like.
Nick, you're right. They made a huge tour thing based off the engine of recreating, like a historical tour. And I never delved into that, but I knew they were pushing that element of learning outside of the fictional story. But what I was trying to, let me conclude so we don't drag on too long about this, is that Assassin's Creed after Unity, which tried to implement a lot of online co-op aspects, and glitches aside, when all is said and done, it's not a perfect game, but it's still a really fun game, and Syndicate was an incredible game, very glitch-free, but it missed its heyday because so many people were just coming off of hating Unity for all the glitches, that a lot of people missed out on trying Syndicate, which was 18th century London, which was really cool. But once they went to Origins, ancient Egypt, the franchise mechanically went from an A to B quest, item hunting only type adventure to being a much more heavier set RPG. Now, they didn't completely fine-tune it in Origins. They made it a huge open world like all of them have been, but they incorporated a leveling up system, a very in-depth armor, weapons, upgrading system, a crafting system. They made it very heavy. They leaned heavily into RPG elements while maintaining the whole seek out your history type setting for any of the Assassin's Creed series. And then the follow-up to it, I know Odyssey's the newest one. Valhalla's coming up. That's the newest one coming up. What came after Origins? Was it Odyssey? The Romans?
Origins and Odyssey. I actually want to play Odyssey. Okay, because I'm a big fan of ancient Egypt. I mean, ancient Greece.
Ancient Greece, yeah. Odyssey took everything that Origins started with and just improved upon those elements. You know, all the RPG heavy stuff. And for all intents and purposes, every critic and article that I've read has said that Ubisoft is continuing to push that RPG element that they started with in Origins, and now Odyssey, and now Valhalla is going to continue with that. But I guess, if anything, to take away from Valhalla in our reaction to it, is that the lead creative designer for Valhalla worked on Black Flag, and Black Flag was primarily known for its naval combat aspect, which has never been seen in any other iteration of the series, except, right? Am I right, Lynn? Black Flag is the only time they introduced seafaring combat, and then he also worked, I think. Listeners, viewers, correct me, or you guys, if I'm wrong, but I think the guy that did also worked on Black Flag also led development on Unity, as far as, like, the co-op, the combat, a lot of the good aspects of what people liked about Unity, not the glitch shit, obviously, because no one wants that listed on their freaking resume, obviously. Yeah. I was known for the glitches in Unity, but for the combat, the co-op, and then Black Flag introducing naval combat, they said they're going to have a mix of those things in Valhalla. You're going to have naval combat with Vikings, and you're going to command a group of people, but you're also going to have the aspects of the more traditional Odyssey and Origins RPG elements. So they're still going to have the RPG elements, and they're bringing Black Flag naval combat back.
Yeah, that's what I'm reading into it too. So one of the cool things you get to do is you get to create your own unique Viking raider. And yeah, your friends can actually use them in their raiding party.
Yeah, so, Nick, when you bring up about customization, this is kind of like, this is them leaning, Ubisoft leaning the heaviest they've ever done as far as, with all the previous games, it's had RPG elements, but you've had a set character. Now they're literally letting you customize head to toe what they look like, and so they're bringing every element of what RPGs are, while trying to give you that open world Assassin's Creed, you know, running around and climbing up shit, you know? So, concluding thoughts on that is just, I'm excited for it. I bought Odyssey on a discount last month, so I can't say I'm like, I'm such a hardcore fan, I bought it on day one. I bought it at 50% off, guys. I'm not gonna lie to you and say that I am a fanboy of all the games. But I love trying them out. I love getting into them and seeing what they offer. And the thing I want to instill in our viewers and listeners, at least my perspective, any gameplay videos you guys watch on our channel that I'm leading, I come to it with a childlike perspective. And that doesn't mean I'm immature about it or that I can't be critical about it. It just means I want to take games for what they physically are and just get lost in them and then share with you how fun or not fun it was based on the experience and not all the development and the hardware outside of what I'm in. Now, that's why we have this pop culture talk show. We like to talk about the nitty-gritty of how things are working, how things are developing, the popularity of shit. That's what we want to do, but I want to, like, promote us as gamers, you know, and you guys ever watching our playthroughs to just see us as just people that are just getting lost in and into the game we're playing. And so I encourage you guys to check out all our playthroughs, our co-op catch-up videos, you know, and or our full-blown playthroughs of games that have come out and are going to come out. Before I shut this down, Nick or Lynn, because this has kind of become like a secondary episode, I want to, if you guys have enough energy, it's almost one, we could pick it up next week if we need to, but we had a pretty cool conversation that almost went an hour on its own about Ubisoft and Assassin's Creed, so like that could be just a unique 40-minute, 50-minute episode. And we could save the reaction video portion that we did and come back next week or early midweek, Monday, Tuesday, when you're at work, Lynn. We could try to Skype, Nick, if you're available, Monday through Thursday, one of those nights. And we could, like, pick up our reactions to the trailers we watched.
If I can give my final thoughts on it, I don't have, that's what I'm asking for. I don't have an issue with the Assassin's Creed genre in and of itself.
I just wanted to make sure you knew I was not trying to attack any of your
perspectives. I wasn't attacking Ubisoft or the game itself. Yeah. The only thing that I don't care for is, like I'm saying, is the really chintzy microtransactions and then the day one DLC. Those two things, those murder me as a consumer. Yeah. It's like day one DLC. It's that shit should have been in the game. I mean, if you're going to make it and it's going to be available, but I have to pay extra for it outside of the game, that's rough. And for everybody out there, I can almost say that it kind of feels like you've been, like, if you don't buy into it, the game that you're getting kind of feels slightly incomplete, knowing the fact that it's there. If you don't know that it's there, it's a little bit, I mean, ignorance is bliss, but knowing that there's day one DLC is rough.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, I will say that their turn for taking a break in between titles is good. And it did show in story development and game development, so I will give them credit for that.
Nicholas, I'd like to just, I know you've only made it through kind of the early aspects of the franchise as far as time played, but how are your thoughts coming from Brotherhood into seeing what Valhalla is and what you know it is based on where Origins and Odyssey took the franchise to where we know it's going to be now? What are your overall thoughts with the franchise and the future game coming out?
I think they're riding on the coattails of big pop culture things like the show Vikings and Last Kingdom, but it makes sense. It's a big era. And it's a good time to do it because it's so popular. I just hope they pay it justice.
Yeah, agreed. Are there any titles, just concluding statements or thoughts, are there any titles in the franchise that you'd like to check out after hearing me and Lynn talk about them? Pre-Valhalla, obviously.
I know I want to try Odyssey, and I was wanting to try Unity, but I only wanted to try it if I had people to play it with.
I mean, that's a fair statement. I did a lot of it solo. I did do a little bit with Matt back in the day when it was out a year after it came out. So, Nick, let's keep in talks in the future, because I have the game down. I have all the games on my console, so I'm not against jumping in for a little bit of co-op and something very different like that. Since none of us, we've done Destiny for so long, and all of us are on a huge hiatus from that.
Been playing it every day.
Well, way to put me in an awkward disposition of clarity. We'll talk off air, Nicholas. I'm sorry. All I'm saying is if we
I've been playing it with the Brayhan.
Well, are you playing it right now? Because I see he's on there.
No, right now I am playing...
Shout out to Brayhan. Nick is Fable. Screwing you because he's not playing with you. Sorry. Anyway, this is going to not have any context because this will come out a day or two from now and no one listening will understand. Anyway. All right, well... All I was saying, Nick, is I'd be down for if that's something you'd be curious to at least play a little bit on. We could try to find some co-op time to jump in. But, those are all our concluding thoughts, I think, as far as the Assassin's Creed Valhalla reveal is concerned and its previous iterations and how we have felt about the franchise up to this point. Guys, in case I don't clarify this at the beginning, thank you for joining us for this interesting, I want to call it like a side quest conversation, if you will, regarding gaming and things of its ilk. This stemmed from our main episode conversation about reacting to the 13 games that Microsoft revealed in their Xbox Insider program. So stay tuned for that episode. We're getting back into the swing of things, back into trying to do a weekly thing here. It's been missed by us as far as we enjoy having these conversations, and hopefully you guys have been missing it too. So in conclusion, guys, we are on YouTube at the Nerdentials channel. We're on podcasts where any podcast can be found. And just stay tuned for some more consistent content from all of us nerds here at Nerdentials. We're going to keep up with doing some gaming videos, co-op gaming stuff, and we're going to keep the pop culture nerd conversation going into the infinitesimal, as far as I'm concerned. So, guys, this has been your Nerdy Essentials for myself, Lynn, and Nick. Thank you for watching, and as always, nerds, we'll see you on the other side. What's cool is I only got two tracks, and I can easily sync him up with us.
Oh, yes.
Gonna cheese it, Nick. Gonna cheese it.